Merry Christmas, State Road Advent Christian Church, and welcome to Candles and Carols. This is my third Christmas at State Road, and when I first came here, I hadn't heard of Candles and Carols, had never been a part of a Candles and Carols, and maybe you're joining us online, and you never have either. So let me tell you what you're about to be a part of. Candles and Carols is this great Christmas tradition here at our church family, where we just sing praises to our God. We love Christmas time, we love our God, and we love to share the good news of Jesus' coming into the world. And that's what this is all about. We are not professional musicians. This is not intended to be a slick production by any means. It is just a heartfelt offering from our church family to you that just wants to share the joy of Christmas. And so I hope you enjoy this time as we enjoy the great story of Jesus' coming into the world and why he came, and also as we sing praises to him. So welcome to Candles and Carols, and Merry Christmas.
Love. going to be reading from Isaiah 7:14 and Isaiah 9, verses 6 and 7. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end, on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it, with justice and with righteousness, from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
Boy, it is cold out here, but that really warmed my heart. That was just really wonderful. So settle in. I hope you've grabbed some more hot cocoa, and we're going to continue with some more Christmas praises to our Lord.
The Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire. This was the first census taken when Quirinius was governor of Syria. All returned to their own ancestral towns to register for this census. And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, his fiancée, who was now obviously pregnant. And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her first child, a son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available for them.
Special story that's going to be read to us by Linda Gehagen. It's Three Trees, and it tells the whole story of God's plan to redeem fallen man. And of course, this has everything to do with Christmas. So whether you're a child or a child at heart, I hope you really enjoy hearing this wonderful story.
This is the tale of Three Trees. Once upon a mountaintop, three little trees stood and dreamed of what they wanted to become when they grew up. The first little tree looked up at the stars, twinkling like diamonds above him. "I want to hold treasure," he said. "I want to be covered with gold and filled with precious stones. I will be the most beautiful treasure chest in the world." The second little tree looked out at the small stream trickling by on its way to the ocean. "I want to be a strong sailing ship," he said. "I want to travel mighty waters and carry powerful kings. I will be the strongest ship in the world." The third little tree looked down into the valley below where busy men and busy women worked in a busy town. "I don't want to leave this mountaintop at all," she said. "I want to grow so tall that when people stop to look at me, they will raise their eyes to heaven and think of God. I'll be the tallest tree in the world." Years passed. The rains came, the sun shone, and the little trees grew tall. One day, three woodcutters climbed the mountain. The first woodcutter looked at the first tree and said, "This tree's beautiful. It's perfect for me." With a swoop of his shining axe, the first tree fell. "Now I shall be made into a beautiful chest," thought the first tree. "I shall hold wonderful treasure." The second woodcutter looked at the second tree and said, "This tree is strong. It's perfect for me." With a swoop of his shining axe, the second tree fell. "Now I shall sail mighty waters," thought the second tree. "I shall be a strong ship for kings." The third tree felt her heart sink when the last woodcutter looked her way. She stood straight and tall and pointed bravely to heaven, but the woodcutter never even looked up. "Any kind of tree will do for me," he muttered, and with a swoop of his shining axe, the third tree fell. The first tree rejoiced when the woodcutter brought him to a carpenter shop, but the busy carpenter was not thinking about treasure chests. Instead, his work-worn hands fashioned the tree into a feed box for animals. The once beautiful tree was not covered with gold or filled with treasure. He was coated with sawdust and filled with hay for hungry farm animals. The second tree smiled when the woodcutter took him to a shipyard. But no mighty sailing ships were being made that day. Instead, the once strong tree was hammered and sawed into a simple fishing boat. Too small and too weak to sail an ocean or even a river, he was taken to a little lake. And every day he brought in loads of old smelly fish. The third tree was confused when the woodcutter cut her into strong beams and left her in a lumberyard. "What happened?" the once tall tree wondered. "All I ever wanted to do was stay on the mountaintop and point to God." Many, many days and nights passed. The three trees nearly forgot their dreams. But one night, golden starlight poured over the first tree as a young woman placed her newborn baby in the feed box. "I wish I could make a cradle for him," her husband whispered. The mother squeezed his hand and smiled as the starlight shone on the smooth and sturdy wood. "This manger's beautiful," she said. And suddenly, the first tree knew he was holding the greatest treasure in the world. One evening, a tired traveler and his friends crowded into the old fishing boat. The traveler fell asleep as the second tree quietly sailed out into the lake. Soon a thundering and thrashing storm arose. The little tree shuddered. He knew he did not have the strength to carry so many passengers safely through the wind and rain. The tired man awakened. He stood up, stretched out his hand, and said, "Peace." The storm stopped as quickly as it had begun. And suddenly, the second tree knew he was carrying the king of heaven and earth. One Friday morning, the third tree was startled when her beams were yanked from the forgotten woodpile. She flinched as she was carried through an angry, jeering crowd. She shuddered when soldiers nailed a man's hands to her. She felt ugly and harsh and cruel. But on Sunday morning, when the sun rose and the earth trembled with joy beneath her, the third tree knew that God's love had changed everything. It had made the first tree beautiful, It had made the second tree strong. And every time people thought of the third tree, they would think of God. Merry Christmas.
Luke 2, verses 8 through 14. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. They were terrified, but the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests."
Yeah. Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 1, verses 18 to 23. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When, as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all of this was done, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us.
The Christmas tree with lights aglow stands stately in our home. The light it throws into this room beckons all hearts that roam. As I sit quietly, watching shadows form, I am reminded gently that I am not alone. My Savior came to live among the lost and desperate souls. To free our sin-bound hearts and minds was his intended goal. So upon himself he took our sin as the Savior of this world and offers shelter and joy and peace in his eternal fold. He came to seek the lost, among whom surely I am chief. His completed work upon a tree healed my soul-sick grief. The lights steadfastly glow with hope that someday we will see the true light of this world in all his majesty. My prayer this season for all men is simple and quite plain. Holy Spirit, use all Christmas lights to proclaim Jesus' name.
When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph, and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
In fear. There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle and makes his home. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the hopeless, confused and torn, and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go light your world. Light his own candle some other way. See now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to, still holds a candle without a flame. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the light up the sky, praying to our Father in the name of Jesus. Make us a beacon in darkest times. Carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the helpless, deceived and poor. Hold out your candle,
Well, if you would go ahead and grab a candle and have that ready, we're going to be lighting them in just a moment. Here, as we come towards the end of our time at Candles and Carols, I want to share with you a brief thought out of Scripture. In Luke 2, verse 11, it says this, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." The Christmas story is always doing this thing, this amazing thing, where like a yo-yo, we look up and then we look down. We look up to high exalted language of a Savior and a King. The name of the great King David is invoked, and it's sung out over the plains by a choir of angels. And then after looking up, we look down into the mean streets of Bethlehem, a small, unimportant farming community in a backwater corner of the Roman Empire called Judea. And there, our attention is drawn by the Bible to two teenagers, Mary and Joseph, so poor that they have no room, they have no place to stay. We also see, hurrying excitedly through the darkened streets of this small town, a group of shepherds who have just come from an amazing encounter with an angelic choir. But most of all, we look down, down, down into the amazing depths of a manger, where we see the great Almighty God, the Creator, the one who pre-existed the moment when all creation came into being, who has now, in a very mysterious way, become a part of creation. The great Creator God lying into the depths of the manger as a small baby wrapped in swaddling cloths. The Christmas story does this. We look up, we look down. High and exalted language followed by low and humble language. And really, this is a story of the church today. In his coming into the world, a picture of the church, which is this miraculous mingling of divine power and ordinary humans. We see the high and the lowly. When we gather in church on Sunday, we sing praises to an amazing God. And then we look sideways at people who, amazingly, our God has come to reside in. God dressed in flesh. What an amazing story. And one of the great turning points of the great story that we're living in, the story of God's plan to redeem all of us out of this fallen world and to make of us his own children, is the moment when Jesus came into the world as that little baby. He came on a rescue mission. And today, if you're a believer, you have been rescued and you know the fullness of the joy that comes with our Christmas celebration. Gift giving is a wonderful Christmas tradition. And at Christmas, we celebrate that most amazing gift. We celebrate the gift that is most satisfying, exciting, unexpected, and the longest lasting. We celebrate the moment when God gave us himself. And in Romans 6:23, this is just exactly how God puts it. He writes this, "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Maybe you're listening to this right now and you have never received that free gift of God in Christ Jesus our Lord, the free gift of eternal life. If you'd like to receive that gift this Christmas, here's what you need to know. Jesus came to the earth at Christmas time. He became one of us. The great eternal God put on flesh and dwelt among us. And he took that body to the cross. And there on the cross, he allowed himself to be hoisted up, beaten, nailed to the cross, and murdered in a shameful public way. And in so doing, he took our punishment onto himself. The punishment we deserved was meted out on him. And there comes the great transaction that is at the very heart of the Christian faith, at the heart of the gospel. When Jesus took our sins onto himself, his perfect righteousness is transferred to any and all who would put their trust in him as their Savior. This is the free gift of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord that Romans 6:23 talks about. The first part of Romans 6:23 says that the wages of sin is death. And a wage is different than a gift in this very important fact that a wage is something we earn. It's something we deserve. And so it says the wages of our sin, the wages of our rebellion, all the ways that we have disobeyed God and his righteous commands, is that we're deserving of death. But God doesn't give us what we deserve. He's a God of grace and mercy, who rather than giving us what we deserve, wants to give us a free gift, a pardon. The free gift of life in Christ Jesus, eternal life. And so if you'd like to receive that gift this Christmas, all you need to do right now is just bow your head in prayer and pray this very simple prayer with me. You can do it right where you are. And just know that getting the words just exactly right is not the most important thing. God knows your heart, and the words may not make perfect sense, but God, again, just sees your heart. So just bow your head in prayer. You can pray this very simple prayer with me and receive the free gift of God, which is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, I know I'm a sinner. And Father, I know that I am deserving of punishment. But Father, I believe and I receive with great joy this Christmas the fact that Jesus took my punishment onto himself and he has given me the free gift of eternal life. Father, I confess my need for a Savior. I know I can never save myself by being good or keeping commands. I need Jesus to do this for me because I could never do it for myself. And Father, I just pray, Lord, that you would help me to follow Jesus. God, that you would give me a love for righteousness and that I would follow him as my Lord all my days, from now until the day when Jesus comes back. And I thank you so much for this wonderful Christmas gift of salvation. Well, if you just prayed that prayer with me, you're a new creation. You're a Christian. And I'm so excited that you received the most amazing Christmas gift this Christmas. If you've already received Christ, though, as your Savior, and you are already a Christian, then I would invite you to take this candle and light it. And think about this as you do so. Jesus said in the Bible that he was the light of the world, but he also said that we are the light of the world, and by that he means that his light now shines in us, his church. And as we go out into the darkness, as you drive along the streets here in Aroostook County, we see the Christmas lights twinkling back in the darkness along people's houses and things. And just think about the light of Jesus shining out of your life and how if you touch your light to another candle that is not yet lit, that they become lit as well. And so we have this amazing thing here this Christmas where we get to go give people God. We get to give people God. We get to give people salvation in heaven. Those things have been given to us to give to others. And so I hope you go out with great joy, as the shepherds did when they left the stable and proclaimed with great joy the good news that they had heard concerning the baby that was lying there in the manger. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to those on whom God's favor rests. Merry Christmas. And right now, with our candles lit, let's sing Silent Night.
Child.
thank you for joining us here for Candles and Carols 2020. It certainly has been an unusual year. This has been an unusual Candles and Carols, but I'm thankful for everybody who took part in it. It was a real blessing and an encouragement. I'm sure it was wonderful for you to be a part of as well. You can go ahead and extinguish your candles now as we close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, even as we blow out our candles, we're so grateful for the eternal light that shines and will shine on into eternity, and that even now is shining forth from the lives of your people. And Father, I pray that as we go out into this dark world, that we would shine as Christmas lights this season and always. God, I pray, Lord, that you would make yourself visible through your church. God, as we walk in the light of Scripture, Father, I just pray, Lord, that we would walk together in a unified testimony, that your light would shine in us and that we would make you visible. Father, I just thank you so much. We love you so much. We're so grateful for this time of year when we celebrate the amazing fact that Jesus came to be a son of man so that we could become children of God. And God, that's what we are. We're your children. And we're so grateful for the ways that you have captivated us, you've satisfied us, you've shown us wonderful things to surprise us. And Father, we look forward to an eternity with you. And Father, just thank you so much for all these wonderful things. Thank you for my friends who use their gifts and their talents to bless us with this time. And Father, here as we close, as we walk away from this time, Father, I do just pray that by the Holy Spirit, you would help us to shine in this dark world, that others would see you in the midst of your church. In Jesus' name, amen. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Ho, ho, ho.